मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई होप एवरीवन इज स्टेइंग हेल्थी एंड सेफ एट होम। टुडेज क्लास वी आर गोना सी अबाउट नैनो डेंटिस्ट्री। दिस इज नथिंग बट नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी एप्लीकेशन इन डेंटल फील्ड, स्पेशली इन आवर स्पेशलिटी कंजर्वेटिव डेंटिस्ट्री एंड एंडोडोंटिक्स। सो कमिंग टू द कंटेंट्स, we are going to see about introduction, history of nanotechnology, definition, importance of nanoparticles when compared to the bulk counterparts, and various approaches in the manufacture of nanoparticles, then application in conservative dentistry, followed by application in endodontics. First we will see the introduction. The term nano is derived from the Greek word dwarf. So nanoparticles are microscopic particles with one or more dimensions, exist in the range of 1 to 100 nanometer, which we usually say 10 to the power of minus 9. And we can see that the size of nanometer exists between the size of the atom. They used to say the length of the two hydrogen atom is equal to 1 nanometer. Next, coming to the history, Richard Phillips Feynman is the first person who gave the concept on nanotechnology. He spoke about the miniature of computers, or he said that storing of large amount of data in a small piece of like a pen drive. He told about like so we can store a lot of materials in a small container kind of. But he never used the term nanotechnology. Later, Norio Taniguchi is the person who coined the term nanotechnology. Then Dr. Eric Drexler used the concept of Feynman and published a book on nanotechnology. There has been various definition for nanoparticles, nanomaterials. The most accepted one is this European Commission's recommendation, which states that nanomaterial means a natural, incidental or manufactured material containing particles in an unbound state or as an aggregate or as a cluster, and where 50% or more of the particles in the number size distribution, one or more of its external dimension exists in the range of 1 to 100 nanometer. Next, what is the importance of nanoparticles? So why it is important when compared to microscopic or macroscopic particles? There are three main advantages which you people should know, is that it offers unique physicochemical properties such as ultra small sizes, large surface area to mass or volume ratio, and increased chemical reactivity when compared to their bulk counterparts. Okay, ultra small sizes, because of very small size they will be more chemical reactive, and we can functionally we can modify into anything, and large surface area or to volume ratio, we can incorporate lot of particles when compared to microscopic particles. Coming to the approaches for the manufacture of these nanoparticles, there are various approaches. First one is the top down approach, next is the bottom up approach, and third one is the functional approach, and fourth one is the biomimetic approach. So coming to the biomimetic approach, biomimetic is nothing but mimicking the biological tissue or structure. Third one is the functional approach, but these two approaches are still in the phase of studying only in the research. So top down approach and bottom up approach are the two approaches by which nowadays nanoparticles are manufactured. What is this top down approach? Top down approaches means they bring the nanoparticles from the bulk material. We can see in this picture, from the bulk material, by using process like mechanical milling, etching or laser ablation or electro explosion, they will bring the bulk counterpart into nanoparticles. The exact opposite of that is the bottom up approach. From the atomic level, by using chemical or physical process, they build a nanoparticle or nanoclusters, combining some nanoparticles to a nanocluster, or by using an atomic level particles to a nanoparticle. An example for top down approach is the manufacture of nanocomposites. So coming to the classification, nanoparticles are classified based on either availability, either naturally occurring or synthetic. They may be further categorized as organic or inorganic in nature, and based on the shape, they are classified into particles, spheres, tubes, rods, and plates, and so on. So these are the classification based on composition. Inorganic, we see the zinc oxide, iron oxide, titanium dioxide, and various oxides. And in metallic, we can see silver, gold, iron, copper, and magnesium. And in polymeric, we see alginate and chitosan or chitosan. And in quantum dots is nothing but a group of semiconductors which absorb light and emit light. And the last one is the functionalized width. It is based on the functional approach. Depending on the function, what we needed, we will modify the nanoparticle either as a drugs or as a adding photosensitizer to the nanoparticles. The photosensitizer itself is a nanoparticle, and as an antibody by adding immunoglobulin as well as proteins. This is the picture which represents all the functions, shape, size, and the availability, everything of the nanoparticle. First, we can see the size. It available between 1 nanometer to the 100 nanometer, and shape, it may be sphere, cube, rod, star, or plate. And depending on the material, whether it is organic, inorganic, or metallic, or quantum dots, and whether there is functionalized nanoparticles, means whether there is any surface modification happening, like surface charge, and we are targeting specific group like antibody or peptide, or we are modifying the functional group of the nanoparticle, or we can encapsulate a nanoparticle for its extended working time, like other coatings which can be done. Next, coming to the application in conservative dentistry. So first is the, you people all know that nano fillers are incorporated in composites. This nano, it is an old concept, and it is available in the market also now. So nano composites are classified mainly into nano fills and nano hybrids. So the main difference between nano fills and nano hybrids is, in nano fills, the filler particles is only of nano size, whereas in nano hybrids, filler particles, it's not only of nano filler particles, there will also be combination of micro filler particles and macro filler particles. Different filler particle sizes will also be present in nano hybrids. How they manufacture these nano composites? This is fabricated by pyrolytic precipitation process. This is the process by which they manufacture colloidal silica. Colloidal silica is nothing but the common filler particle used in composite. If you people forgot this pyrolytic precipitation process, you can go to the DM restorative resin chapter and see the microfilter particle where it will be written. Like, it is nothing but silicic acid is heated in the presence of oxygen and hydrogen to form colloidal silica. Same thing with the nano composites, nano filler for composites. They use the same precipitation process. And the advantage of these nano filler particle in composites is that you can incorporate lot amount of filler particles in a resin matrix, so that advantage is that the properties can be improved. So once the mechanical properties are improved, you can use it in posterior as well as stress bearing restoration. So coming to nano hybrid and nano fill, which one will be good, which is the best in case of mechanical? If you ask, nano hybrid is the best. So various research has told that nano hybrid has a higher strength when compared to nano filler particles itself. So here the two pictures which we can see that nano hybrid consists of microparticles as well as nanoparticles, and they can be used in moderate stress bearing areas, whereas nano filler particles are used only in anterior and non-contact posterior areas. That means it will be used in class 1 kind of cavities only, not in contact areas. And it contains only either nanometer particle filler particles only, either silica or zirconia. These are the examples of nano composites, nano fill, as well as nano hybrid composites available in the market. Coming to the type of nanocomposites, this types is classified based on the modification of resin matrix. Resin matrix, which normally we use, is the BIS-GMA, Tech-DMA, UTMA. But later modification, after the once they initially they modified the filler particles, later now they are modifying the resin matrix. Instead of using only the BIS-GMA, Tech-DMA, they are combining this nano fillers like metal matrix nanocomposites, where the metal oxides are added to the resin matrix, or ceramic matrix nanocomposites, or like ceramic fibers, or as polymeric material are added to the nanocomposites. These are in the developments and it will be available in the market. If it is of, if the function or it's, it has a lot of advantages, means it will be used for a very long time. Next is the nano solution. Nano solutions are nothing but nano adhesives or dentin bonding agents. Here in the picture, if we see, there is a restoration or composite restoration. The restorative margins between the dentin and the restorative is enlarged here. We can see the micro leakage. Micro leakage, which we commonly encounter in all the restoration, especially in composite, there is a polymerization shrinkage or bonding doesn't happen properly. Here we can see the micro leakage that happens between the bonding agent and the collagen matrix, which is the collagen mesh. Whereas nano leakage is one which we can't see directly, which occurs inside the collagen mesh itself. So these may cause some failure of the composite restoration, which will affect the clinical entity. So nano solutions or nano adhesive system represents the new generation bonding agents having single step application. These solutions are composed of uniformly dispersed nanoparticles such as nano fillers. It has properties like increased bond strength and reduced particle settling, so that nano leakage can be prevented. This is an example of nanotechnology dental adhesive from Dentsply Prime and Bond NT. Next is the nano light curable glass ionomers. We all know that the main advantage of glass ionomer is the fluoride release, and the disadvantage is that fluoride release is not throughout the whole lifetime, and the disadvantage is that it is very less. The strength of the glass ionomer and polishing ability of glass ionomer is very less. Hence, this modification by using nanotechnology has happened with glass ionomers. This nano light curable glass ionomers combine the nanostructures like nano fillers and nano cluster fillers with the fluoroaluminate silicate technology. That is, the fluoroaluminate silicate glass is the powder composition of glass ionomer. They combine these with the fillers, nano fillers or nano cluster fillers. By bonding these nano fillers, the properties like fluoride release, improved aesthetic, excellent polish and wear resistance are incorporated in the glass ionomers, allowing easy mixing and dispensing, which make them ideal restorative material. So by modification of this glass ionomer, we can satisfy a range of clinical indication, like we can use it for class 1, 2, 5 and then core buildup also. This is an example of nano hybrid glass ionomer restorative. Next, coming to the application in endodontics. Before going into the application in various materials and application in endodontics, first we will see why it is required, why nanomaterial nanoparticle is required. Whenever there is an infection, the conservative management for the infection involves either topical or systemic antibiotics. But there are several factors which prove ineffective, which prove these antibiotics are ineffective. The factors which prove antibiotics are ineffective are classified into mainly two: microbial factors or antibiotic misuse. So antibiotic misuse means excessive or inappropriate prescription of antibiotics. Antibiotic which is not even needed, they will be taking, patients will be taking. This will result in the patient resistance to that antibiotic, as well as some microbial factors. This is the main factor. There has been resistant, various resistant mechanisms of microorganism. There are like methylene resistant Streptococcus aureus, like vancomycin resistant Enterococci, and some genetic material exchange of microorganism have made them resistant to various antibiotics. So what will we do if they are resistant to this antibiotic? What will we do if we are resistant to this antibiotic? Thing is that the number of new antibiotics which comes into the market is very less. Like for example, we can see this graph. This is an 5-year interval. This is by from Anil Kishan's article, which he quoted this article saying that from 2010 to 12, we can see the number of new antibiotics came into the market was very less, whereas in 1990 to 1984, the number of antibiotics were very high. So the new antibiotics which is coming into the market is very less, and we have to tackle this resistant microorganisms, and as well as we have to reduce the antibiotic misuse. So because of the shortcomings of these antibiotics, all the infection control will be based on this thing called topical therapy, or in period people would have learned about local drug delivery. Similar to that, we have to apply that in endodontics also. In endodontics, mostly we won't we use antibiotics, system antibiotics, or only for treating acute condition, but main pain, everything will be resolved by disinfection of the root canal only. So disinfection mainly involves either root canal preparation by using file as well as irrigating solution. Irrigating solution plays a main role when compared with the root canal preparation. So now we see what are the nanoparticles available and how it is applied, what is its mechanism of action used in irrigating solution or medicament in endodontics, as well as its clinical significance. The first one which we are going to see is chitosan nanoparticles, which is nothing but poly 1,4 beta D glucopyranosamine. So it is a deacetylated derivative of chitin. Chitin, it is a most abundant natural biopolymer. So this chitin is present in like crabs, everything. I will show in the next slide. This hydrophilic polymer with large number of, it consists of large number of free hydroxyl and amino groups. So by using these free functional groups, we can subject to numerous chemical modification and grafting, resulting in functionalization of the nanoparticles. So this is the picture which I told that chitin which is present in various crab, I told, no. So crustaceans are the family name where which this chitin is available. And chitosan, the advantage is that chitosan has an excellent antibacterial, antiviral and antifungal properties. In case of bacteria, gram-positive bacteria were more susceptible when compared to gram-negative ones. So the minimum inhibitory concentration is ranged from 18 to 5000 ppm depending on the organism, pH and degree of deacetylation, molecular weight, chemical modification and the presence of lipids and proteins. So the degree of deacetylation is known to influence the antibacterial activity of chitosan. With higher the DD, the number of amine groups, and I told, no, the number of free functional groups like hydroxyl amine groups is are the mainly responsible for the antibacterial activity of chitosan. So the number of the free functional groups depends mainly on the number of degree of deacetylation. If it is higher, the number of free functional groups will also be higher, and higher will be the antibacterial efficacy. Coming to the mechanism of action of chitosan, so chitosan are cationic nanoparticles which will be attracted to the negatively charged like substrate or biofilm attached to the tooth surface, or if you consider it as an microorganism, the cell wall will be negatively charged, so it will be by the process of electrostatic interaction they will easily get attached to the external polysaccharide membrane of this cell wall, and when it get adsorbed to the cell surface it increases the permeability of the cell wall and it goes inside that. Then later it causes the membrane disruption and the release of constituents from the cell and thereby cause of death of the microorganism. This is the mechanism of action of chitosan, and most of the nanoparticles will have the same similar mechanism of action. Coming to the clinical significance, chitosan nanoparticles hold significant potential to achieve improved root canal disinfection, whereas there are some cases where pus everything will be their chronic infection in root canal. So tissue inhibitors such as pulp and serum albumin inhibit the antibacterial effect of chitosan nanoparticles significantly. These are the results which are given by various studies. So we can functionally modify based on these tissue inhibitors in the research. We can conduct it in future trends, and we can modify the chitosan nanoparticles and improve its antibacterial function. Next to the chitosan nanoparticle is the bioactive glass. This bioactive glass received a considerable interest mainly because of its osteoinductive effect. Osteoinductive effect means it will induce the nearby cells to form particular cells to be structured to be formed over there, and it forms as a matrix. And it has an antibacterial properties also. Mainly it was used in orthopedic application, and later because of its effect they are used in dental application also. Bioactive glass consists mainly of silicon dioxide, sodium oxide and various other oxides at different concentration, and it depends on the local physiological changes and for its antibacterial effects. Coming to the mechanism of action of bioactive glass, the antibacterial activity of bioactive glass depends on the following three main factors. First is the high pH, second is the osmotic effects, third one is the calcium phosphate precipitation. High pH is that an increase in pH because of, we said that bioactive glass consists of various metallic oxides. So when it releases ions in an aqueous environment, that will be increase in pH. It will be because of this antibacterial activity will happen. Next one is the osmotic effects. An increase in osmotic pressure above 1% is an inhibitory effect for many bacteria. So bioactive glass, one of these osmotic effects, and the third one is the calcium phosphate precipitation. It induces the mineralization of the bacterial surface. It causes deposition of calcium and phosphate, and like calcium oxide is one of such composition of bioactive glass. This calcium get deposited in the bacterial surface and it gets calcified, and it will cause the lethal action of the bacteria. So furthermore, the release of calcium, sodium, phosphate and other oxides could lead to the formation of bonds with the mineralized hot tissues like silica, phosphate, everything. It can easily attach to the tooth structure, or it forms a bond and acts as a matrix, and it will stimulate the osteoinductive property. Coming to the clinical significance of bioactive glass, there are some in vitro studies which showed that the bioactive glass has a significantly less antibacterial effect when compared to the calcium hydroxide, which is the traditionally we used to prevent residual bacterial growth. And one more point is that when compared to the nano bioactive glass as well as microparticle containing bioactive glass, microparticle containing bioactive glass has a tenfold increase in silica release when compared with the nano particle containing bioactive glass. Hence, it can be used, but it has proven to be less clinical significant and less antibacterial activity. The last one is the silver nanoparticles. Silver is known to produce an antibacterial effect by acting on multiple target sites, like interaction with sulfhydryl groups of proteins, DNA, alteration in the hydrogen bonding, respiratory chain, unwind the DNA and interfere with the cell wall synthesis or cell division. So silver nanoparticles are known to further destabilize the bacterial membrane and increase permeability, leading to leakage of cell constituents, same as that of chitosan. Coming to the clinical significance of silver nanoparticles, 3.8% silver diamond fluoride is tested to be effective against E. faecalis. E. faecalis is the organism mainly responsible for the failure of root canal. It will mostly associated with the re-root canal or secondary infection of the root canal. So 0.02% of silver nanoparticle gel, if you use as a medicament for 7 days, it was found to be significantly better in E. faecalis biofilm disruption compared with calcium hydroxide groups and syringe irrigation with higher concentration of silver nanoparticle solution. So the study which quoted below says that if we use a lesser concentration of silver nanoparticles as a gel, it has a better effect when compared with calcium hydroxide as well as a silver nanoparticle solution. But the disadvantage of silver nanoparticle is toxicity and staining. As I already explained, the functionalized nanoparticles is manufactured by using functionalized approach. It is nothing but a combination of nanoparticles with photosensitizers have been found to enhance photodynamic therapy. Like for example, camphroquinone is used as a photo initiator. So if we combine like photosensitizers with the nanoparticle and inside into the root canal, and we activate that light by using an LED light or laser, then this nanoparticle gets activated and its function is started happening. So similar to that, it is what I told is just an example. Similar to that, various approaches to modify these nanoparticles by using functionalized approach is happening. So optimization of concentration and application method of these particles are under constant progress. So till now research is still going on, and similar to this functionalized nanoparticles, biomimetic approach is also is at the research level. So this picture represents, these are the table consists of various studies using nanoparticles. We can see various nanoparticles, bioactive glass, chitosan along with zinc oxide, and this bioactive glass with of different sizes, chitosan and various, they have been used. I said functionalized nanoparticles, no, that rose bengal functionalized with the rose bengal is an solution. They functionalized with the chitosan nanoparticles. They tested with the various bacteria and observations are happened. So these studies are found to be little proven, and still research has to be made for nanoparticles itself. Apart from this application, what I told for conservative dentistry and endodontics, there are various other applications also, like toothpaste, like even in Sensodyne, there are incorporation for dentin hypersensitivity, like Biomin, Novin Biomin, we can see that is made of nanoparticle, and even root canal sealers are made of nanoparticles, cavity varnishes caries preventing agents, even in mouthwashes. And last recent research is going on is tissue engineering, that is nothing but regeneration. So where their tissue scaffolds are made by using this nanoparticles. So coming to the conclusion, nano means don't think that nano because of only the size is more than enough, but we need lot of things. If by reading this picture itself, you will be able to understand not only the size, even the small size should have a specific function which is equal to or greater than that of micro or macroscopic particles. I think this is of enough for you till the UG level. Assignments are two essay questions. Define nanotechnology, write in detail about advantages of nanoparticles, what are the available sources and mechanism of antimicrobial action with diagram. So write a note on metal nanoparticles and its uses in endodontics is the second essay question. So the assignment should be neat, clear, and it should include synopsis. It should be highlighted the important points, and it should be submitted in Google Classroom. This is the assignment link for the Google Classroom. You people have to enter and submit it. I want those who submit along with their please submit along with their name and roll number so that it will be easy to grade. If anyone doesn't follow the proper guidelines, they will be marked as absent. In case of any queries, doubts or feedbacks, you can, people can free to contact me on this number, or you can mail me to this mail ID. So if you didn't understand anything, or if you want one more class, if you have any doubt, you can contact me. Or any doubts regarding assignments, you have to contact me only. Okay. Thank you.